Today, we're taking the assignment to the heart of Atlanta, the home of historically Black colleges like Spelman and Morehouse, and a movement of Black Greek life organizations animated by the rise of Vice President Kamala Harris. I wanted to know how the membership of Black fraternities and sororities, known as the Divine Nine, might swing things in a battleground state like Georgia. With Black women a solid Democratic electorate, what more can a sorority do for Harris? Where can they make the difference? And is this a turning point in their storied history of activism? I'm Audie Cornish, and this is The Assignment. So first, Congresswoman, thank you so much for being here.
Absolutely.
Describe where here is.
So we are in the West End of Atlanta, a historic neighborhood where lots of civil rights leaders have came and made their mark from all over the country. But we're in the heart of Georgia's fighting 5th Congressional District that I'm honored to represent, serving in the legacy of Ambassador Andrew Young and the late Congressman John Lewis.
Now, before you were able to win this seat that the famous John Lewis had for many, many years, you were also in the world of politics. In fact, you were also working with Stacey Abrams, and that is a campaign that has helped shift Georgia, right, in so many ways. Can you talk about where the organizing that you were doing has informed the organizing that you think the Divine Nine and Black Greek Letter organizers are doing now, kind of where those meet?
Absolutely. And it might be that the work that the Divine Nine organizations have been doing for generations has informed my organizing work here on the ground. So I was a state senator before I was elected to Congress, and before that, an organizer right here across the Southeast, based in Atlanta. But I met Stacey Abrams years ago when we had this wild notion that we had a lot of untapped potential here in Georgia, where people weren't deciding if they were going to vote for Republicans or Democrats. They were deciding if they were going to vote or stay at home. And so we knew that there is untapped potential in registering voters and organizing voters, but we had to give people something to vote for, not just vote against. And that has made all the difference. Stacey Abrams came onto the scene way before the national politics realized who she was, but organizing here in Atlanta, and was a state rep and then became the minority leader, the first Black woman to lead either chamber in the Georgia General Assembly, and found a way to tap into voters who were looking for someone who was willing to fight for them. And that's what I have learned, that voters want someone who will stand up and fight for them and fight for their rights and their freedoms. And that's what makes me so excited about the work that I'm able to do this cycle with my sorority sister,
yeah,
at the top of the ticket, Kamala Harris, because she's fighting for those freedoms. And you hear a lot about the reframe around joy and bringing joy back to this work. And some people will push back and say, joy doesn't pay the bills and joy doesn't pass policies. But joy is something that most Americans are looking for after so many years of division and hate in our political process.
So what I'm going to ask you about today is a little bit about how that history from Black Greek Letter organizations fits into the history we understand about Black organizing, right? And how that can affect elections. Because the last big major kind of historical project I think of is when the sororities came together in the 1960s and they invited JFK to come and speak and address them. Later on, they went to the administration with literally a binder full of women saying, these are all the women who could potentially, Black women, college educated Black women, who could be in office. So there is this very specific precedent for stepping up during an election year.
I even think...
Oh, is that the train?
Yes.
Okay.
We're at the West End MARTA station.
We are truly downtown. We are truly downtown.
So I even think back to the women's suffrage movement, when we knew that as Black Greek Letter organizations that we weren't even marching for our right to vote, but standing in the gap with women who were marching for women's suffrage to get the right to vote, is the early days of our Black sororities getting engaged in civic engagement and how we were looking to inform the change.
Yeah. But making a mark in turning point moments.
Yes.
That's what I'm looking for. Because in the in-between years, I'm not sure I think of Black Greek letter organizations, sororities, and fraternities as being as active as the Black church, for instance. But what I do see are these like little tipping point moments where you see them come together, the full Divine Nine, and start activism in a way that is about turnout. Do I have that right?
Absolutely. And the turnout piece is critical because it's not just the members of our collective membership for the Divine Nine organization, which a lot of people are catching on right now. Divine Nine, or the nine historically Black fraternities and sororities for college-educated Black people in this country. But the communities that we serve are so much more expensive to just the membership that we hold in our numbers.
And in what way? How is it different from the Black church, so to speak?
So we have our membership, but then we're service organizations. And I think a lot of people are catching on the difference between the sororities that represent predominantly white groups and the fraternities that also represent them, because we're service-based organizations. And so we exist to serve our communities. And so not just our membership, while our membership is doing the work, we are servicing communities that we are trusted messengers in. Like, I am a member of the Alpha Beta Omega Omega chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha in South Fulton, right here in that Metro Atlanta area. And we all have a service area where we do the work of civic engagement, where we are doing the work around economic empowerment. And there's another train.
No, you can keep going. Yeah, yeah.
And so the communities that we serve are accustomed to seeing us there. So when we come back during the election cycle and we are encouraging people to not just register to vote, but to update their voter registration information, and then not just turn out to vote, but take people with you to vote. We're trusted messengers for these communities because we've already been doing the work in these communities.
But can I ask something bluntly, which is that I don't know if Democrats need help getting, for instance, college-educated Black women to vote. Like when
Which
I think
is less about the communities that we serve.
Yeah, so expand on that. Because if you look at the demographics, the black women, especially ones with college degrees, Democrats have that in the 70s, 80%, right? Registration and support.
But that needs to be in the 90s, which we're
working. But are there other communities they need help with, that Harris would need help with?
Absolutely. And I mean, it's the conversation around, it's not just if someone is going to show up and vote for Donald Trump. It is if they're going to show up at all.
But to the point, there's working class voters, college educated voters, and there is a gap there, right? And
but I think you're missing what I'm saying when I'm talking about the communities that we serve. It's not our membership. It's communities in like the West End. Like there's a chapter that serves right here in the West End, where we have children who might not even know that college is within their reach, even though the Atlanta University Center is in walking distance from here. And so those are the communities that we serve every day to make sure that every child growing up here in the West End understands that whether they are looking for an apprenticeship or a college education, that there is a pathway to success in this country. So we serve communities. We don't serve ourselves as a membership. And so those are the people that we are working with every day to make sure that we are going back and doing the voter registration and the civic engagement about and talking about the importance of this election cycle and why they should turn out to vote. So it's not about our membership is doing that work. We're not encouraging our members to go and vote because we're going to show up. We're going to show up in force and numbers, but it takes us going back to the communities that we serve every day to encourage them to show up and to give them the reasons on why it matters that they show up to the ballot.
The reason why I ask that is because it has been a criticism, I'd say, like within the Black community about the role of Greek letter organizations,
Absolutely.
About classism, about the things that separate them from the rest of the community. And are those challenges that have to be overcome with these big projects?
Absolutely. And it's a narrative that we seek to reshape and reinform every day. I was raised in rural Alabama in a home with no indoor plumbing and no running water. So I understand the different walks of life that so many Americans live every day. And I know the impact that Divine Nine organizations had on me growing up. and having the ability to.
But you've like heard that criticism before.
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
I have heard that criticism and I seek to change that narrative by the work that we do in the communities every day. And I even encourage my sorority sisters and other Divine Nine members to, we have to look outside of the bubbles that we get to live in because it is a privilege to live in this space. And so we have to understand that when we make it to certain points in life, there are a lot of other people that we have a responsibility to bring along with us. And I was that little girl who needed someone to look out for me and give me these opportunities. And that's what our Divine Nine organizations do every day, open doors of opportunity for people who never even knew that they existed.
What do you think is kind of a lesson learned from past attempts at turnout operations? From specifically this kind of Greek life community?
So I think part of it is the self-organizing and preaching to the choir. And we have to get outside of our silos and our bubbles. And it's not just about us feeling good about the work that we're doing, but the impact that our work can do. And so we have a collective group of people who are organizing every day here, but also bringing other organizations into the fold because it's about the collective work.
Give an example. What do you mean outside?
So right here in Georgia, there is a group, a consortium of organizations who are just working on civic engagement. And now our Divine Nine organizations are coming into that fold. Instead of doing the work just by themselves, working with these other organizations on the ground, there's an organization, Pro Georgia, was an umbrella organization for other groups on the ground doing just civic engagement, not telling you who to vote for, but go and vote. And so these organizations who are 501c3 organizations, just like our Divine Nine organizations, are doing this work together now. Instead of in the past where Divine Nine groups would do their own work and then these organizations are also on the ground doing their part of the work, now it's a collective. And the collaboration makes a huge difference because then you can, you know, who's going in what areas and who's working on what so that there's a greater impact and we can get our work to scale.
And then it's not just for show also, because I can imagine in the age of social media, it's very easy to perform activism that's not actually reaching the people you need to reach.
Not reaching the people and not just about feeling good about checking a box. This is not a checkbox. This is about actually doing impactful work that will lead to outcomes that change our communities. And it just happens that we have the opportunity to do this for one of our own this cycle.
You talk about one of your own, and I am interested in how Vice President Harris sort of changes the game, so to speak, because of her affiliation with AKAs. One of the people we heard from was former New Orleans Mayor Marc Morial. And he said, I mean, people had a different feeling around Barack, referring to Barack Obama. Barack was symbolic. Barack was not Divine Nine. Barack was not HBCU. I have two ways of thinking about this. One, that you, despite all the numerous people who have been members of the Divine Nine, whether it's Thurgood Marshall or John Lewis, that have this history. But in the end, the person who became the first African-American president, biracial president, didn't. So what does it feel like now? I mean, does it actually, do you feel a difference in energy or support or interest?
So I definitely have heard people saying that it feels Obama-esque, the organizing that is happening. But I feel something completely different on the ground here, especially in Battleground, Georgia, where we are have the largest consortium of HBCUs in the country and all of these Divine Nine organizations based here. And so the energy around it is different when you are organizing for one of your own. When Vice President Kamala Harris showed up at, I guess, these sorority parties that are actually boules doing the service work in our organizations, she showed up as understanding what she was walking into and understanding the work that happens year-round in our organization.
And it's intriguing because the former president, when he first entered the race, there was a struggle in winning over African-American leaders, especially in the South, some in Congress. And there was a little bit of like, who is this guy?
And she, an HBCU alum, Howard University, and just all of the different connections make a huge difference because then she has these validators that are out there way before she even has to enter a space or a room, validating who she is because they know her lived experiences. And she, the fight that she has for our HBCUs is different because she's an HBCU alum.
Is this the beginning of something, the end of something, a turning point? When you think of the Divine Nine and its participation in this election, where do you see it?
Well, I think it is definitely the beginning of more people paying attention to the work that we're doing, especially now where so many of our Divine Nine organizations are starting political action committees so that they can endorse candidates and can be more engaged. I know that my sorority has an affiliated PAC that was just formed. I know that the men of Omega Psi Phi have an affiliated PAC that they have formed so that they can get more engaged. The men of Kappa Alpha Psi have worked with the Crimson PAC for cycle after cycle now, but it's not getting a lot of attention because that is not the main work that they're doing in the community, but it is new work that is definitely worth elevating because it is a difference that we can make when we're winning elections like we did in Georgia by only 11,780 votes, then we know that every vote matters. And if we have trusted messengers for communities, getting those people out will make the difference.
Well, Congresswoman Williams, thank you so much for talking with us here. And for
in the heart of the fighting,
fighting fifth by the train station. Thank you so much. I appreciate
thank
it.
You, thank
and
you.
Thanks for being on the assignment.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. After my conversation with Congresswoman Nikema Williams, we spoke to another member of the AKAs, Myesha Land, creator of one of the sorority's most viral voter turnout efforts, Stroll to the Polls.
So strolling is a culture that we do in Black Greek organizations that was actually created by Alpha Kappa Alpha in the 40s. We used to call it party walking, where you did choreography and you went to a party and you did it together, or you came to the campus and you demonstrated your pride for your organization. It then became a fitness opportunity as a dance teacher, a dance school owner, that I did for about a year and a half prior to COVID. When COVID hit, I couldn't open up my dance studios. And I was watching just people on the internet, people online, on social media, particularly Facebook, talking about how depressed they were, how trapped they felt. So I decided to take my listserv of people and create a Facebook group called Stroll Through Fitness. I would literally have a free stroll class online in Facebook Live. And every weekend, the theme would be different.
So you're taking this choreography that's part of your culture, being in a sorority, and for you, again, this is part of your community. You're not thinking very much of it.
Not at all.
What happened when it kind of caught attention?
So when Kamala Harris became the first woman to receive the Democratic nominee for vice president, the theme that weekend was to celebrate her. I coordinated a class with each organization to teach the same stroll in a different version. Then we decided we were going to record it. It was simply to celebrate her nomination.
But it was also distinctive because, as you said, you know, these organizations, they have their own distinct traditions, right? Mm-hmm. Their distinct choreography. To come together is not all that common in these kind of everyday moments.
Yeah, you don't see a lot of unity strolls. We have a very healthy competition.
Yes.
we're going to call it healthy competition, right? With one another, even though we serve some of the same support systems in our communities.
What this reflects is that unity is not so easy.
It's not.
Even within the sorority community, there are many political differences.
Very much.
And sensitivities. What has it been like in this election year? Are some of those differences surfacing in the group chats, in the conversations about politics?
So for the first time, you saw For the first time, and I can't say this, I'm only 50 years old, I turned half a century day before yesterday, but for the first time that I can remember in a very long time, for our people, Stroll to the Polls made voting celebratory, not obligatory.
I see, because we also have this element, especially in the Black community, of, you know, voting is our right, heritage, responsibility, it's hard fought, It is all work.
Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod. Felt the days where hope unborn had died. Right? It's this thing we carry like a cross, like Christ's cross. And sometimes the heaviness of it causes an anxiety that prevents people from wanting to participate. Stroll to the polls, change that. I remember breaking down crying in my car as I was at a voting, the first day of early voting, and someone sent me a message with women from Florida walking through a park. And of course, they, you know, these were older members, and so they were just doing the church step clap, you know. If you're a Baptist, you know what I'm talking about. but you know how the choir comes in, right?
Yeah.
I call it the every praise clap, right? But there were hundreds of women walking to a park to go vote with their blue and gold and red and white and pink and green shirts they had made themselves, and they had these skirts, and they were trying to reproduce what we were doing, and people were reproducing it all over the place, and they were singing and chanting and going. And I really, for the first time, it hit me. We're about to change the world, sister.
When it comes to Kamala Harris, she doesn't really need help winning over more Black women, right? She doesn't.
Or does she?
Tell me more.
We are not monolithic.
Because we have been hearing more about Trump curious voters, especially younger Black voters who don't feel the same allegiances to the institutions like Black churches or Greek letter organizations.
Absolutely. Having these own conversations with my own child.
Who is how old?
24.
Okay.
Sitting with sorors and undergraduate chapters and Black Greeks who are 30 and below and having this conversation, we make assumptions that are not so. I am the daughter of a Democratic mother and a Republican father. I'm the daughter of a father who chaired Black Republicans for Obama. We are not monolithic.
If you've lived, if you're 24, you have lived through the election of the first African-American president. It's not some faraway conceptual thing. And you don't necessarily, I would think, politically feel like you need to adhere to a group dynamic to be a political individual.
I remember playing in my great-grandfather's shoes and knowing him personally. I have never done anything to verify this, but from what I understand, from what my grandmother shares with me, my great-grandfather's, from what I understand, father was a slave. I knew someone who was a living slave or whose parent was a slave. That context doesn't exist for them.
For your own child, who's 24.
For my own child.
In a way.
I remember as a child going to, right now, if you take the street, Lee Street, it's going to turn into Main Street. And in about 4 miles, there's a place called J.R. Crickets where all the Black people go to have wings and have a great time. That used to be a Shoney's. And I remember going to the Shoney's on Saturdays or Sundays and the Klan in full garb standing out and passing out pamphlets. And from that Shoney's on the property, and you bought a pamphlet. I remember my mother giving me the money to walk up to that Klan's member and buy a pamphlet. And I went inside and sat at that Shoney's breakfast table, and my mother and I read what was in there and had conversations about it. Because my mother taught me, if you don't understand how other people think, you can never fight it. You have to understand it.
So to your point about this, when you think about someone like your own child who's in their mid-20s, it also makes me think of the fact that at HBCUs, their voting rates lag behind white institutions, predominantly white institutions. Is some of the stroll to the poll effort, some of this energy, is it directed at women like you, or is it directed at a different generation?
When it first was created, it wasn't directed at anything. It was a celebration.
But now that it's a movement, who are you hoping to mobilize?
I am mobilizing young people. As a matter of fact, the recruitment of the filming that we're doing this weekend has more younger people in it. Members of Clark Atlanta University's chapters or recent graduates from various colleges that have a younger appeal and a younger look. I think it's important to see that type of engagement. But at the same time, we have to motivate them to vote and we have to educate them in why their decisions are important. And not just for this presidential election, because the people that impact your everyday lives are your local elections, and people don't vote in their local elections. I think what we have in this election is an opportunity to see ourselves for the first time in places that we never dreamed of seeing ourselves as women of color.
Does this require the Divine Nine or people who are in these organizations to start to believe that they can be politically active. You don't have to back a candidate, but could these organizations be doing more and not just in the big election years?
So every year for Alpha Kappa Alpha, I know for Delta Sigma Theta.
But they just started a political action committee, right? And
right.
They're not the only one. So clearly there is a decision to be more active.
There's a decision.
And was this a long time coming? Did this take too long? How do you think about it?
There's a decision to be brave. So you have to remember in politics, there are politics and there's politrics. Everyone is with you when they're looking, but when they're not, you're under attack. And so what I think I see a lot, not just in our Divine Nine, but in African-American organizations, particularly those who hold 501(c)s or nonprofit corporations, is this attack using codes of tax or codes of law when you win to attack you. So what you see is, in order to mobilize, for years African-Americans have moved in silence to avoid the tyranny that comes afterward when the cameras are gone. So there have been conversations of, oh, we can't do this because we're a nonprofit. But many people, even our members, don't understand there are different types of nonprofits.
And there is a fear that we're vulnerable to political attack if we step up and are too public.
Absolutely. And these particular 501s can endorse in state and federal elections. But then you also have to remember, again, our organizations are not monolithic. We have Democrats, we have Republicans, we have independents. So when you start to talk about endorsing particular candidates, you also start to ostracize those members who don't have an opportunity to support the candidate of their choice through this organization. And so it's a very delicate walk. And I think a lot of times when you don't see that visibility, you see us more with voter registration, you see us more with those things that seem to be nonpartisan, it's because we have to balance the harmony of our membership as well, right? What does that look like? And for the first time in a long time, particularly as women of Divine Nine sororities, finding this balance, and I'm not speaking on behalf of my sorority or anybody's sorority, I'm speaking as my Isha and what I see. And I think that's important, is that I did this on my own. Stroll to the polls was something I did on my own.
So Georgia, people think about it as a swing state now. It could be very close. You gave the data, right, about how many potential voters could be out there that you could bring into the system. What are you hoping that this moment is for Greek letter organizations? Is it a stepping up for a long-lasting movement? Is it just for this cycle? What would you like to see?
A member of Sigma Gamma Rho in a meeting that I was in said something so profound that it has rested in my spirit. And this is what I want us to do. Voting for my family is a culture, it is a tradition, it is an inheritance. There was a time when I was a little girl that my mother would get me dressed up and I'd go vote. And she let me select the persons that she was selecting. This is back in the hanging chair days when you used the pin to poke. And every time she went, I went. I was expecting it. I knew when voting day was. I did the same with my daughter. She would get dressed. I remember the first time I went to vote without my daughter, she had an entire conniption fit on me. You have to start family legacies. There was a time when we dressed up and we went to church together. My sister and I, we put on furs together and we go vote, or, you know, they're fall furs, but, you know. We have to create this legacy of family inheritance, the way you gather together at the Thanksgiving table. But this young sister said, we are not apathetic about voting. We are ambivalent about it. Because I've watched you. We've watched you. We've watched you go and vote. We've watched you. And everything that you make happen for us in a 3 to 4 period of year of time, they make a rule and they reverse everything you do. And we don't want to be a part of that. Why fight for something that's not going to be there? How do we make this so that what we do matters and it sticks, because everything you all fight for us, we fight and we fight and we fight and we're tired. They are emotionally tired from watching us fight and not just experiencing their own pain, but watching their mothers and grandmothers fight and lose, and having that sense of mourning, knowing that the women that fight for us can't really change it in their opinion. So does the fight really matter? And I say to them, it matters. Because baby, if you can't move the line, hold the line. Hold the line, we need you. Hold the line, we need you. Because it's just like car maintenance. You can drive your car, but if you don't put oil in it, you don't put gas in it, you don't maintain it, eventually the car stops working. That is what voting is. It is a maintenance of the vehicle that you have to make differences in your community. Hold the line. Maintain it. We need you, young people. Men, we need you. Women, we need you. And we can't do this alone. As a people, as Divine Nine sororities, as Divine Nine fraternities, there are not enough of us. But as you join us in our fight, you have to understand that you have to stay in the fight with us, not just when it feels good for you to look good and say, look, I'm allying with the African-American community or the woman community. You have to stay in the trenches. And that's it. That's what I say. Stay in the trenches. We need you.
You can hear more of this conversation on the Assignment podcast. We're taking the show on the road to meet the people shaping the election in the weeks ahead. Find us online or wherever you get your podcasts.